Good morning. Welcome to Covenant Word Church in beautiful Key West, Florida. There may be a little rain out there, but we are all sunshine in here with the Son of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, hallelujah. It is great to be in the house of the Lord. Where two or three are gathered, He is in our midst. So I came expecting to see Jesus because I brought Him with me. How about you? Y'all got Him with you today. We're going to open up this morning with Psalms 27:4. Says, one thing I have asked from the Lord that I shall seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to meditate in His temple. So as we gather today together, we're going to lift up our hands and we're going to seek His heavenly face. And our prayers is that you have an encounter with the most holy God, that you are definitely changed from the person that walked through that door because you had a touch of the Father's love this morning. So let's go in prayer this morning. Father God, we just thank you that we can come together in your name. And we thank you, Father God, that you love us and that you provide for us. And more importantly, Father God, that you are changing us. I thank you, Father God, that you are with us. And I pray for each and every person here, Father God, that they truly come face to face with you and that they are changed for what you have and that they can walk in the boldness and with the courage of what you have called them to do. We know that we have an assignment, Father God, and we just thank you that you equip us to accomplish that for your glory and your honor, advancing the kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. Thank you, Lord God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Morning, we get to come in here and lift up His holy name. Amen.
Lord, you are good. Your mercy endures. Your mercy endures forever. Lord, you are good. Your mercy endures. Your mercy endures forever. You are Jehovah, and there is no other like you. You are Jehovah, and there is no other, no other God like you. You reign, you reign. Let every generation come and praise your name. You reign, you reign. Let every generation come and praise your name. Lord, you are good. Your mercy endures forever. Lord, you are good. Your mercy endures forever. You are Jehovah, and there is no other. Jehovah, and there is no other, no other God like you. You reign, you reign. Let every generation come and praise your name. You reign, you reign. Let every generation come and praise your name. The horse and the rider thrown into the sea, and I know He'll do the same for me. He is faithful, He is true. And I know He'll do the same for you. The horse and the rider thrown into the sea. And I know He'll do the same for me. He is faithful, He is true. And I can't wait to see what He will do. He reigns. Let every generation come and praise His name. He reigns, He reigns. Let every generation come and praise His name.
Come on, we get to lift Him up this morning. He has changed us in such a magnificent way that he can do so in other people's lives. Amen. He changed my heart.
He changed my life.
He raised me up.
He raised me up.
He changed my way.
He changed my way.
He lifts me up.
He lifts me up.
He's got a plan.
He's got a plan.
And I know God will do what he has said. He changed my heart.
He changed my heart.
He changed my life.
He changed my life.
He raised me up.
He raised me up.
He changed my way.
He changed my way.
He lifts me up.
He lifts me up.
He's got a plan.
He's got a plan.
And I know God will do what he has said. He raised. He raised. Let every generation come and praise his name. He reigns, he reigns. Let every generation come and praise his name. He reigns, he reigns. Let every generation come and praise his name. He reigns, he reigns. Let every generation come and praise his name. Your mercy endures. Your mercy endures forever.
Now I'm on. Am I on? Praise the Lord. I was never really off. But until I push the button back in the sound booth, they tell me I'm not on. Am I on this morning? Yes. Praise the Lord. Thank you. You're all beautiful too. How many know the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, it says, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God that are pulling down the strongholds. Yes. Paul talks about that, but he also talked about the armor over in Ephesians where it says, put on the full armor of God. So he talks about weapons and he talks about honor. Armor. Would it make sense that we're in a warfare? If not, we're dressed up for a parade. I don't think that's the case. Praise the Lord. I was going over this and I was meditating on this a while ago, but it says, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. That means they're not fleshy. They're not something we invented. They're not a physical weapon, a physical sword or anything like this, but they're weapons nonetheless. And I got thinking about this, and I remember Jehoshaphat, when he went to the Lord, and he said to the Lord, he says, I'm surrounded by the enemy. What shall I do? And God said this. He says, send out the praisers. Send those out that praise. He said, in other words, leave the guys with the weapons in the background. He says, send out the praisers. He said, and this battle is not yours but mine. So how many know that we know from the Bible that the plan of attack is in any given situation is, if it's, is it, first of all, is it God's battle or is it our battle? If it's God's battle, then let's fight it his way. I believe on a bigger, larger picture this morning in the town we live in and different things we've got to do, I believe this is God's fight. Amen? But what we're commanded to do is co-labor with him in this thing, and co-laboring this morning, I'd like to take him and just for a minute, be conscious of my weapon of praise as a weapon. Amen. Against the enemy. And if God has ordained our praise as a weapon against the enemy, it will work. I said it will work. Yes. There's a big difference between that and coming in and doing a religious service of some sort and just religiousizing, going through the motions, singing song number, whatever. And then listen to a bald-headed preacher preach and then go home. And then nothing gained, nothing lost. We just took that time. How many know that's not what we wanted in a church service? Because a church service, Jesus said this. He said, "Where two or three are gathered in my name." That makes it right there in his name. And two or three are gathered in my name. My spirit is in the midst of those that are gathered. In other words, he's right there. If it was important enough for Jesus to show up in church, I think it's important or very important for us to be here with him. Amen. So in this, in saying all that, the Lord is here. Our music has already become a weapon, but our music not directed at the enemy, but directed towards God. Now it becomes what the Bible says as an offering. or a sacrifice. Let the sacrifice, let the fruit of your lips, that's your song, or you say, be a sacrifice unto him. So we'll offer it up as an offering this morning, and guess what? God will take care of the things we can't. And we'll just go ahead and concentrate on worshiping him. But I just want you to be aware of that your worship this morning becomes a weapon against the enemy. Amen. Oh, you didn't know you had an enemy? Amen. You do now. Praise the Lord. Amen. So without going through all the armor, I like to, we do that with the kids and show them what a helmet looks like. And in our war room, we actually have a period correct Roman armor set up there. And it's got all the things labeled out as it says in Ephesians. But the fact that without putting on, without going through all that this morning, how about we just take and sing unto the Lord? One of the biggest things that will push against the, because James says, he says, resist the enemy, he'll flee from you. Yes. But the verse before that says, humble yourself before the hand of God. Right. And now resist the devil and he'll flee from you. How many want to see a fleeing devil this morning? Praise the Lord. But more than that, more than seeing a fleeing devil, because that's easy, I want to see an encounter with God this morning. So I came here this morning not just to push back on the devil and go into warfare. I came here this morning to have an encounter with the Holy Spirit, to have an encounter with God and to recognize his presence in the room and be empowered by that and be strengthened by that. Praise the Lord. How many are with me? Do I have anybody with me? A couple of people? Got some more? God's moving. Wait a minute. How many are with me this morning in what I just said? Praise the Lord. All right. Now, you got a song that will fit along with that? Praise the Lord. Let's do it. How many know that here's how it goes. I instruct our music team. This, our music team leads. Here's the thing. If nobody follows the leading of our music team, they just became entertainers. And the devil's not concerned about entertainers. He's only concerned about those that put the weapons of his warfare, which is praise. Amen? So, huh?
Amen.
Oh, okay. let's boil down to this. So basically, that's a polite way of saying, hey, let's sing along with what they're singing along, and let's come in agreement with that prayer and with that position this morning. Praise the Lord. Go ahead, Christian. Let's sing it to the Lord.
We sing to the God who always makes a way. And he hung up on the
Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. Oh, oh, oh. We shout out your praise.
Walls are coming down. Fear is coming down in His name this morning. We get to move forward in the freedom that He has given us. Amen. I can see it this morning. God is going to break some strongholds. God is going to move this morning. And it's amazing that throughout the Bible, that there are stories like Pastor talked about last week with Gideon. He saw himself as something less than what God was telling him through the angel, saying that you're a mighty man of valor. And he kept saying that, no, I'm not, no, I'm not, until he got in cooperation with the Heavenly Father that he was able to free a nation. Amen. Can we do the same thing this morning? Can we sing unto him and break these chains and take down some giants this morning? Amen.
I'm not a warrior, I'm too afraid to lose. I feel unqualified for what you're calling me to. Lord, with your strength, I've got no excuse. 'Cause broken people are exactly who you use. So give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense, so I can face my giants with confidence. You took a shepherd boy and made him a king, so I'm gonna trust you and give you everything. I'll be a conqueror, 'cause you fight for me. I'll be a champion, claiming your victory. So give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense, so I can face my giants with confidence. Gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. Won't stop until I see them fall. Gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus, Jesus. I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. Won't stop until I see them fall. Gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus. Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense, so I can face my giants with confidence. Yeah! Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart. I'll face my giants with confidence.
For those of you on live stream, we are going to do our communion, so you can now prepare or gather the elements, and I will turn it over to Pastor Kevin for our communion.
Amen. You can have a seat, and Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. This is our communion table. Can we have this moved back just a little bit? Who set this here? Did you set this here?
I did. I'm
okay.
Sorry.
Just move back just a little bit. Okay. You see that right there? That's the center mark right there. Praise the Lord. I'm going to get a matzah thrown at me. Just messing with him. Praise the Lord. I think it's, yeah, it's straight. Praise the Lord. Very good. Thank you. Oh, I explain. This is our communion Sunday, which is the first Sunday of the month. Amen. I like to start off the first Sunday. Amen. And can you all hear me?
Yes.
I am on then.
Yes.
Okay, praise the Lord. I like to be on opposed to not being on. I set this up. This is kind of a display table more than anything else, but it serves its purpose because what happens when I was studying for the communion, I like to know why I do things. In other words, we could be brought up in the church and taught something, well, you do this at this time and do that at that time, but I like to know the reason for it. And everything we do here at Covenant Word Church has a biblical reason behind it. And there's a history that God has given us in these things. And I like to go over the history and always understand what we're doing. How many know Jesus was Jewish? I mean, that may be a revelation to some people, but he was Jewish. Matter of fact, every book of the Bible that you have, 66 books in the Bible, all been written by Jews, okay? Praise the Lord. The fact is in that when Jesus gave us the communion, he gave us just part of what was part of his Passover celebration. Passover celebration, as you know, if you've ever studied it in the Jewish culture, is a happy time. It's a time of celebration. It's the family getting together. They have the Seder plate and stuff like that. They do different things, and it has different symbolism. How did it all come about? Passover came about when there were slaves in Egypt about to be delivered. Jesus stands up in that ceremony that they have done for generations, and he takes and gives us what we call the communion, but he takes just a part of that ceremony and he breaks it down. It's like saying, okay, now you're enslaved to sin and bondages, but here I'm here to set you free.
Amen.
So it's almost like a freedom coming upon us again in the spiritual sense. And this is why I like to go back over to things. On a Jewish Passover table, you'll see some chalices here. They're empty, by the way. We're not using those, but we're just using the symbolism of them. The four chalices here, they'll put them up on the screen as far as the scripture. They have remembrance, salvation, redemption, and nationhood. This is the promises, four promises that God gave to Israel before he took them out of Egypt. Each one of those promises he gave them, and Exodus chapter 6, praise the Lord, right there, 2:6, and that's where we get the four chalices from. I like this because basically I was studying this one day and I found out that in all these four promises we find Jesus. Well, let me bounce it off you like I normally do. It's okay. How about remembrance? Yes. Jesus said to do this communion in remembrance of him. Remembrance is not forgetting something, all of a sudden being reminded. No, that's not what it means at all. Remembrance means to memorialize. Yes. In other words, this is something that's going to be ongoing for the rest of the generations. Yes. So that's in remembrance. Yes. The same as Israel today. Okay, but anyway, then he says salvation. How many know our salvation is in Christ? It's in by no other name but Christ. So he brought us salvation. How about redemption? Has Jesus brought us redemption? Absolutely. And what about nationhood? The kingdom of God is a nation. And we are members through Christ of the kingdom of God. And there we have it. What's this fifth chalice over here? Well, this comes from Israel, by the way. It's called the Elijah cup in Hebrew terms. Paul mentions this cup as the cup of blessing, and this would be the cup that was set out at the end of the table. At the end of the table, we find another matzah with a plate. I put it at the end of the table because that's where it fits. It could be any place on the table, but this particular matzah and this particular cup was never touched. It's not touched in the Jewish household at all because this is a place setting for the Messiah. Can I encourage you this morning to make a place for the Messiah? Jesus.
Yes.
Jesus needs a place in our homes, not just a place in our church. Jesus needs a place in our jobs, not just a place where we come and worship him. Jesus needs a place, and he's asking us for a place. That's what this symbolizes in Jewish custom, that we make a place for the Messiah. The Messiah is welcome in our home. The Messiah is welcome into our life. Yes. And I kind of like that because it says Jesus is welcome in our house. Jesus is welcome in our home. He's welcome in our church. Yeah. Amen. And we uphold that. So this particular matzah, in this particular, in Jewish custom, in the Passover, this is not touched. Nobody eats of this because it was set out for the Messiah. So they set this out for when the Messiah someday will come and partake of it. So it's set aside for him. We give him a place. When Jesus sat down 2,000 years ago, when he sat at the Passover, this is the matzah, and this is the cup that he picked up. He didn't take anything off the rest of the table. He took it right from here. And he picked up this matzah. He picked up this, well, not this exact matzah, but this from this place setting, and he picked up this cup. This is what he passed around. In other words, you have set this for generations. You have given set this out in expectations. I am now telling you, I am here. This is mine, and this is what I'm going to do with it. Amen. We're going to pass it around to everybody. Not this one. We got some other ones. I'm just using it for a demonstration. And he said, I'm going to pass this cup around. Because this representation that you've been setting out for generations, so to speak, this representation is a representation of my body and what it's about to go through. This is before the crosses, before the, and this is what it's going to be. If you look at a matzah, matter of fact, Jennifer had a class, matzah class last night. We make our own matzah. Praise the Lord. It's round. You ever see square matzah? That come out of a machine. Round matzah doesn't, handmade. Praise the Lord. I believe Jesus did not have matzah that came out of a machine. We want to get as close to the replica as we can. And by the way, we have grape juice this morning that comes from the vineyards in the Carmel Mountain, one of the oldest vineyards in Israel. We import it. It's not alcoholic, but it's imported from Israel. So we have the flour that makes the matzah from Israel. And so we kind of we stand in agreement with Israel this morning as far as their land that was promised by God. That is theirs. Praise the Lord. And we'll get to that. But so this is the matzah Jesus did. He picked it up. If you look at the matzah, it's got the holes because Jesus' body will have the holes in it when he goes to the cross. This is before he goes to the cross. But there was two punishments that Jesus suffered. One was a whipping post for the stripes on his back. And then the other was the cross, the redemption for our sins. And Isaiah said it this way. He said, by his stripes, in other words, the beating, that one beating is for our healing. The other shedding of blood is for our redemption, for our sin. So two offerings were given at the same time. Jesus, the only sacrament in the church has two elements to it. Water baptism, only one. So praise the Lord. So this is what it is. He took this and Jesus took it and he broke it. And he broke into pieces and he began to pass it around, as you know, to his disciples. And he commanded them to eat. This is my body, which is given to you. Why matzah? Matzah is not made by with any kind of yeast. Yeast in bread makes bread rise. That's why matzah is flat, crispy, crackery type thing, because there's no yeast. Yeast is a type of always used sin. Matter of fact, before a Jewish Passover can begin, they have to go through the entire household and they rid the entire household of any kind of yeast, yeast products. We get rid of it because as a symbolism, we're getting sin out of our house. Amen. So this is what Jesus said, this is my body. My body is sinless. I committed no sin. My body is sinless, and it's been broken for you. And Jesus began to pass around. On this table here, this is a three-position pouch. And what we do with this pouch is in the middle, there's matzah in the middle. Now, this is the matzah you will eat. This is the matzah they take out. They put matzah in all three compartments in a Jewish Passover, but they take out the middle matzah. Because they say this is what the three pockets mean is Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, which are the three heads for the covenant. I put a Christian twist to that, and I said, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Either way, They take out Isaac, we take out the son, which is Jesus. But anyway, in that, so you see where we set up the communion table so you understand where it comes from. This is what it's about. Jesus took this tradition that he had for thousands of years, generation to generation. He boils it down to just this, to represent himself. And then he says, keep this as a memorial. Do this as a memorial. As often as you do it, he doesn't say how often. He said, as often as you do this, eat this bread and drink this cup, he said, you do show my death until I come. One interesting fact, all three of the synoptic gospels get it right as far as, I mean, they all say the same thing. Jesus didn't partake of this matzah or the grape juice, or the wine, whatever you want to say it. He didn't partake of it. But he did give us a promise and said, I'm going to have this meal with you again when you come in my glory. That's going to be the one final communion that we do. So what are we doing this morning? This morning is we're taking this as a memorial and we're remembering the promises of God, number one. We're recognizing what God has done for us, number two. He sacrificed us. By his stripes we're healed. We can get a healing in our body. Last night, Harp and Bowl meeting got out of control. Amen. It just went nuts, in a good sense, in a good way. Amen. But praise the Lord, we started praying for people and praying for healing last night right here in the church. And I just started praying for people. We were getting healed and they're hooping and hollering and all kinds of things going on last night. Yes. And what did we do last night at Harp and Bowl? For every prayer meeting, we partake of communion. Yes. Amen. And I asked a question of about depression, different things like this, and some raised their hand and said, well, let's start praying. And it was that, then it was another thing, there was another thing, another thing. And before you know it, our Harp and Bowl turned into a ministry meeting to everybody here. We had a good time anyway, and we believe that God showed up at our prayer meeting last night. Thank you, Jesus, with the miracles and with signs and wonders, and we're just thankful for it. We just had a great time. Amen. So this is what we're partaking of. I want you to know what you're doing this morning before you do it. If you've been here a while, you've heard the same speech quite often. But it doesn't hurt to be reminded, because today is a different day. We do this particular thing once a month, but every prayer meeting, which we have two during the week, we partake of communion again, not the same thing. This is the once a month I explain what this is all about. Now, we have the Passover table. Of course, one thing that's not Jewish on the table is this here with the cross on. There's no cross on the Passover table. That's ours that we put out. We'll use that to pass out our grape juice and stuff. So praise the Lord. Amen. If you need a healing in your body this morning, claim it, because the price has been paid. Yes. Whether you believe it or not doesn't matter, because Jesus isn't going to unpay it because you don't believe it.
That's right.
The price has been paid. He can't take it back. Your sins have been forgiven. Amen. It was all paid for on the same day. Amen. They have a term in the covenant. I don't have time to teach on this because there's quite a few steps to the covenant. But in a covenant, there's a blood walk. And that in that blood walk is when they sacrifice the animals and they walk between the blood, the two people that come in the covenant, and they swear in that blood walk, they swear of the promises they're going to give to the other person. So where's the blood walk for Jesus? Because this one-sided covenant that only he could pull off. It's when they threw that cross upon his back after they beat him. And the blood was dripping down as it was dripping down on the Via Dolorosa, they call it in Israel, in Jerusalem. The Via Dolorosa, Jesus was walking in his own blood. And as he was doing that, he was paying the price for your sin, for my sin, for your healing, for my healing. And he was paying the price of redemption. Jesus did his own blood walk in his own blood. Praise the Lord, that was provided for him. So praise the Lord. But anyway, this is what we do to honor the Lord this morning. We honor him in the sacrifice that he made. And this church will always honor him in what he's done for us. There's no way we can even begin to repay the things that Christ has done. But we can honor him by trusting him. Praise the Lord. And doing what he tells us to do and obey him. Amen. Ushers, come forward. Let's go ahead and... and have the, we'll pass out the communion elements. As you get the communion elements, you'll get a little thimble like this. You're not going to get a big challenge, a little thimble. And if you hang on to it, I'm going to read the scripture, and then we'll partake together. Amen. So praise the Lord. Our ushers and usherettes have gloves on, so they'll hand you the elements. We've done this since the pandemic thing, and so it's cleaner that way. So don't reach your hand in and get your own. We'll hand it to you. No telling where your fingers have been. No, I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. But we just do it as it just works better that way. Praise the Lord. Amen. All right, praise the Lord. Amen. Remember, just hang on to the elements as you get them. Go ahead. Praise the Lord. You need a healing in your body this morning. We believe God in the name of Jesus right now. Miracle in Jesus' name. Praise the Lord. It was His body that was broken. It was Him. He paid the price. Nobody else paid the price. He's paid the price. He paid the price for our healing. He paid the price for our redemption. Give Him thanks and give Him praise, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Okay, praise the Lord. We thank you, Lord. I'm going to read out of 1 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 23. It says verse 24. Where am I reading? I'm reading in the beginning of 23. I've only done this about 10,000 times. Praise the Lord. Amen. It said the Lord Jesus, I should just quote it. The Lord Jesus, the same night, He took bread. And when he'd given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given, broken for you. This do in remembrance." Like, again, the word remembrance is a memorial. Let's partake together. Thank you. And if you need a healing in your body this morning, we claim it now for you in the name of Jesus. Yes. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord. Verse 25 says this, "After the same manner, he also took the cup when he had supped, saying, 'This cup is a new testament in my blood. This do as often as you drink it and remembers me.'" It doesn't say how often, just as often as you do this. In other words, Jesus is saying, to do this, we do this as a remembrance. In other words, as a memorial. It's a thanksgiving. It's a receiving. I don't know how many different ways I can say remembrance, but that's what it means. we're acknowledging and recognizing what Jesus has done. He's forgiven you and I of our sins, and he's restored us.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
To himself. Thank you, Lord. We just praise you. As we partake together. Amen. And he says in verse 26, he says, for as often as you eat this bread, he said, you do show the Lord's death until he comes. And we do that. We thank you, Father. This becomes a new testament, a new covenant. This becomes a covenant meal. I can trace this particular covenant meal, the wine and the unleavened bread, back to Abraham's time. Jesus took it off the Passover and gave it to us and says, this is what you need to do. Listen, if you forget who you are, because what happens is the biggest attack Satan has is against our identity.
Yes. Yeah. Amen.
So if you forget your identity, forget who you are, Jesus can come back to the communion table and partake of that.
Amen.
Understand what Jesus has done for us and understand that's where we live. I don't care about the circumstances around. Nobody cares about the circumstances. God, what matters and what defines us is where we are in Christ.
Amen.
That defines us. Praise the Lord. Never let the devil take your identity. Amen. But that is your identity. We identify with Jesus in his offering. Praise the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah.
Welcome all our visitors this morning who are participating with us in the service. If you can, we have a visitor's card. If you could fill that out, please. And in our church, we have our church app, which we find is a great way to get information and also to communicate with us through the prayer and the praise button. So if you need prayer for anything, you go into our app. There is a prayer button. You submit your prayer needs into there, and we have a prayer group which will pray for you. And once you receive your healing or receive your answer to prayer, please go back in there and hit that praise button, and we will rejoice in the victory that God has given you. Another way to get information at our church is through our website, which you can find our CWC Kids. You can find Pastor's Message, which Pastor's Message is also on Facebook, podcast, and on YouTube. And we will go into our weekly schedule with Monday nights. And I will turn it over to Josiah.
Yo. Here at our church in our war room at 7 p.m., we have our men's meeting. We invite all you men to come out and join us. Build yourselves up in the most holy faith. And we also invite the youth, the young men growing up. It's not just for the adults. Like Raphael.
Yeah. I'm included.
Yeah. Invite your peeps, you know, like. Be like, yo, man, like, you want to come to church with me? Like,
yeah,
it's
cards.
So dope. Like, yeah. It's like so wicky cool, man. Like, or whatever you kids talk about. But back to the holy part. We build each other up in the most holy faith. I can't say that today. It's the matzah stuck in my throat. But we build each other up. We build each other up in as men of God, because you're not going to find that in the world. They're going to break you down, but here we're going to build you up.
Amen.
Like Rob. Start from the bottom, but you're coming to the top with us. Now I pass it over to Raphael for Tuesday nights.
Tuesday nights is our Tuesday warfare, which is great. Just diving into pastor's messages and also just praising the Lord and thanking him for everything he's done for us. Then after Tuesdays, we go on to Saturdays with our harp and bowl. Again, praising him and also just like praying for people. Like Pastor said, on Saturday we really got into it. And just, it's a really awesome time. And You got it?
So for our Tuesday warfare nights, it's at 6 p.m.
here.
We invite all you to come here in here and participate with us in our sanctuary. Like Raphael was saying, it's a great way for us to come together as a group under our Heavenly Father and pray and to bind the spiritual needs that we need, not only in our lives, but in our community. So we invite you to come out and participate with us in that. It's a great night, and it starts at 6 p.m. And I will turn it over for Thursday nights with Gina for our women's meeting.
You're welcome.
All right, top of the morning to y'all. So on Thursdays, we have women's Bible study, and God is really moving. He's bringing us together in fellowship and also breaking down the word that his pastor is bringing. I'm also going to shine a highlight. I didn't prepare them, but I'm preparing them right now. The first Sunday of March, March 3rd, we're going to have a Vision Sunday for women. And we're just going to come along and do what Habakkuk 2:2 says. It says, make your vision plain and write it down, right? So whatever vision God gave you, we're going to write it down, and we're going to watch God move. I'm physically seeing God fulfill things in my life that I did. I wrote my own vision board 3 years ago. So I'm just wanting to share the care and to share the wealth. So, so back to you for Sundays.
Well, so for Saturdays, this Saturday is going to be a fun Saturday. We get to work in the church. It is our work day. So if you can make it, it's at 9 a.m. And we come in here and we work in the house of the Lord. It's a great way to fellowship with one another and also be able to be participating in keeping and maintaining of the house of the Lord. And if you cannot make it on Saturday, we do have a schedule that you can get in contact with us I got the tongue twister now. Don't do that to me. All right, so our email is at information@cwckw.org. You can contact us, and if you find any time during this week that you would like to come and do some of the tasks that we have assigned, we would be more than grateful for you. But if you can make it on Saturday, it's even better. We have a bunch of people here, and it's a great way to fellowship and to participate in the house of the Lord. And then at Saturday nights is our Harp and Bowl meeting at 6 p.m., which we come back here and meet in the sanctuary. We talk about prayer needs. We go over things and prepare ourselves for our Sunday service, and it's a great way to spend our Saturday night. And then we come into our Sunday morning service, yay, which we're here now. It starts at 10 a.m. If you can. We start with our praise and worship, and then we go into pastor's message, which there's just new revelations that God has put into his heart, and it's just moving, not only for our church, but I've seen it in my own personal life with my spiritual growth. And it's a great way to move. And like we said, you can find pastor's message after it airs, because I got no previews for you right now. But you can find it on our Facebook website, the CWC website, and then you can even find it on our app or on the podcast. And now we will go into our tithes and offerings, which you, those in person, we have tithe envelopes on the back of your chair for your giving. For those giving online, there's a Cash App code that will premiere on the screen. And if you do not have Cash App, our address is 5580 McDonald Avenue, Key West, Florida, zip code 33040. And our tithe scripture for today is Proverbs 3, 9, and 10. Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first fruits of all your increase, so your barns will be filled with plenty and your vats will overflow with new wine. Father God, thank you for the tithes and offerings that you are bringing into your storehouse. Let our first fruits be unto you and to be multiplied and overflowing in your house. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Can't escape disappointment, can't avoid the delay. But I don't have to make feeling down and defeated the place that I stay. Gonna rise to the moment, gonna speak through the ways. Gonna push back the doubt that keeps dragging me down when I can't find a way. Don't need to see it, eyes on you, to believe it, for my breakthrough. Before you even move or make a way, I was standing, faith, walk by, faith, live by, faith, before you. I believe, standing, faith, see by, faith, receive by, faith, before you. I believe, it's a season for healing. Season for change, to see miracles happen that no one can fathom as heaven invades. And it's more than a feeling, and it's anchored in praise. And when it's the dark
darkest, it reaches the farthest and opens a way. Don't need to see it. Eyes on you. Won't you believe it? For my breakthrough. Before you even move or make a way. I was standing. Faith. Walk by. Faith. Live by. Faith. I believe. This is how blind men get their sight. This is how dead men start to rise. This is how small things multiply. Nothing's impossible, nothing's impossible. This is where oceans have to part. This is where light cuts through the dark. This is where I see who you are. Nothing's impossible, nothing's impossible. Stir my faith, stir my faith. I will stand in faith. Walk by faith. Yes, I will. Live by faith. Yes, I will. I believe, I believe, I believe. Stand in faith.
Well, praise the Lord. Good to have everybody here this morning. You got the church by the backstroke, or I know Cindy came in this morning and said, she dropped your Bible in the puddle. I said, that's okay. This scripture don't run. Come on, that was a little funny. Praise the Lord. It's going to be one of those days, isn't it? I could tell. Praise the Lord. Anyway, going over the things this week, I'm praying in prayer. I don't know about you. I had kind of a challenging week this week. Nothing major anything in the ministry, but just personal challenges, different things going through. Lo and behold, I got here last night at Harbin Bowl meeting, and I just made the announcement. I said, is anybody here fighting in different things I was sensing this week? And half the church raised their hand. So last night, we just went a different direction and started laying hands on people and got healings and different things happen, and it was just a great time with the Lord. Praise the Lord. It goes to show you that if you get trapped into an habitual thing, a lot of times we can miss God in that. If we come to church like it's a new, brand new day and a brand new church service every time we come together, you can even come through the door and say, this is the day I'm going to get an answer for my prayer. This is the day God's going to, I'm going to have a new encounter with Him. And this is what I want to talk about this morning. The title of my message this morning is Transformation and Empowerment. And our empowerment comes through an encounter with Christ. It's nothing we can do. You can't study your way to an empowerment. You can't memorize scripture to your way to empowerment. Empowerment is something that is given by the Lord, but can I say this? It's generally attached to an assignment that He's already given us. The empowerment of God is usually attached to an assignment. How many know nothing, I wrote this down in my notes, I said, nothing you're facing caught God by surprise. I don't care what we're facing this morning. You may be facing difficulties or problems, but nothing that we're facing this morning caught God by surprise. I want you to know that right off the bat. How many know the enemy works hard? Who's our enemy? Not your neighbor, not the flesh and blood. We don't wrestle against the stinking, I like to say stinking devil. I don't know if he's got a smell about him, maybe sometimes, yeah, but anyway, the stinking devil. The enemy works hard at constantly reminding us of challenges, problems, failures, difficulties, in an effort to keep us disconnected from the things of God that God has for us. I'm going to say that again. The enemy works hard constantly reminding us of challenges, problems, failures, I can put in their shortcomings, difficulties, in an effort to disconnect us from the things that God has for us. It's a spiritual warfare by distraction is what it comes down to. If he cannot stop you from doing what you're doing, he'll distract you from what God has called you to do. And that's basically what it is. I want to share some things. This is kind of where I'm going this morning. Is this okay?
Yes.
All right. You can turn to Matthew 28 if you want to. Some of you probably have this memorized. I got it etched in my brain over years. But I want to cover some things anyway. How many know if I mention to you this morning, I talk about the Great Commission of Christ that he gave his disciples. Does anybody know what our Great Commission is? I'm going to talk about it this morning. In other words, before Jesus ascended to heaven, he spoke with his disciples. That testimony that was given to his disciples, what he told his disciples, is ongoing. There is no place in the scriptures where that came to an end. He just wasn't talking to his disciples. This is how we dismiss ourselves a lot of times from what the scripture says. Well, he wasn't talking to us. He's talking to the church of Corinth. He was talking to the Romans. No. When the word of God comes down, it's given for generation upon generation upon generation. It's not just for the hearing audience at the time it's spoken. So basically, we can take these things and can constantly be reminded of these things. The Great Commission is still going on. How many know that to be true? We have missionaries in foreign countries. I was, for a season, I went to foreign countries and ministered different places like West Africa, Guatemala, Chile, places like that, over Europe, London, England, different places that I was felt led to go to and minister in different churches, helping other pastors. Jamaica? Yeah, I went to Jamaica one time. Imagine that, Ava. So I went to Jamaica one time and praise the Lord and ministered there. So these are things are still going on today. Matthew 28, verse 18 says this, Jesus came and spoke to them came to his disciples and spoke to them. This is at the resurrection, after the resurrection. He hasn't ascended yet. How many know? Jesus went to the cross. He died, was buried. Third day, rose again from the dead. And he showed himself to his disciples and to his brethren. I'm going to get into that in a minute too. But he showed himself. This is the time that he's sharing this scripture in Matthew 28. He hasn't ascended. It's right before he ascends up into heaven. Isn't it amazing? To get into the earth, he had to be born. But to get out of here, he just floated out. What was the difference? Amen. He had to be born to get in here. But once he got, the Bible says, I'll show you sure why. The Bible says, remember when Jesus was baptized? Now, we generally think baptism today is regeneration. We also think baptism is forgiveness of sins. It's a washing. It's a cleansing. If you go to the Old Testament, they don't use the word baptismo. That's Greek. They use the word washing and the Hebrew word for washing. And it was a cleansing. Well, let me ask you this. Did Jesus need washing? Did he need cleansing of anything? But yet he goes up to John and he says, baptize me. I'm going to tell you why the ascension was so easy. Because at that particular time, John didn't want to do it. He said, I'm not worthy to baptize you. He said, baptize me. And he insisted. When John baptized him, Jesus went down under the water in the river Jordan. And when he came up, it said the heavens parted. If you look at that word in the Greek, it's the same word that when Jesus was crucified, rocks were rent. They were parted. Same word. So what happened? The clouds just didn't puff away and go side to side. The heavens were ripped open. Whatever the barrier was built around the earth from the time of Adam's sin, Satan had this container that he was bound in. As soon as Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens were ripped open, and there's been an open heaven over us ever since. So when Jesus ascended, there was nothing to hold him back. There was no ceiling. There was nothing. That thing had been ripped open, and there's an open heaven. Jacob had that prophecy, and he was saying that he saw when he went to sleep, had that vision of prophecy. He said he saw angels ascending and descending on the ladder, remember Jacob's ladder, ascending and descending. What he was seeing exactly what happened when Jesus came up out of the waters of baptism and divided the heavens. and the heavens were divided, and the barrier, whatever that barrier was over the earth, has been removed. So when Jesus ascended, he just floated out of here. Pretty cool. But the angel came and said, why are you guys gazing? He says, the same Jesus that left here is returning. Amen. In other words, guys, stop standing around staring. Get busy. And that was a word not just to the disciples. That was a word to generation after generation after generation. And that's the same word to our generation today. Get busy for the kingdom of God. Let's see what that means. I'll go ahead. In verse 18 of Matthew 28, and Jesus came and spoke to him, saying, all authority, mark that down, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. All authority. Does your Bible say all authority? That means all authority has been given unto Christ. Satan doesn't have any. I want to emphasize that. Satan doesn't have any authority. I have to say that a couple times because I remember when I was doing some work in the mission field and doing things in the mission field, I ran across churches that had more fear of the devil than they did of God. They were seemed to be afraid. I said, why? I had one time, I was in Ghana, West Africa, and I had traveled with four different translators to go around that country. I was out in the bush and every place in that country from Kumasi to Accra. And they were saying, well, we're a little upset, Pastor. We're supposed to take care of you in a meeting, and we got word back that this village that we're going to next, that a witch doctor was going to show up there and call you out or cause trouble in your meetings or whatever. And so we're trying to figure out, how to skirt around it. I says, don't. I says, call him out. I said, matter of fact, I said, give him a personal invitation for me. I like to see him at my meetings. And they looked at me like, huh? Are you nuts? No, he is. And I said, let me tell you something. I've traveled over 6,000 miles, I said, to come here to bring truth and to bring the gospel. I can't think of a better way to come in and demonstrate the gospel than to demonstrate Jesus himself. Jesus doesn't back down from the devil, either do I. I don't have permission, I don't have biblical precedence to do that. They got, long story short, the guy never did show up. And we had healing after healing. We had miracles happen in that meeting. It was fantastic in West Africa. And I liked the four translators, four young guys, they were translators. They just looked at me. They didn't know what to think. They went back. They told everybody what I did, and they were saying, "No, this is what it is. God has given us the assignment, but I can't find one scripture to where He pulled the assignment back. I can hear man's testimony as an observation. That's what they think happened, but I can't find one scripture. If I can't find one scripture, I'm not obligated to move on what somebody thinks." Amen? Praise the Lord. All right. He said, all authority has been given unto me in heaven and earth. He said, go, listen to this. Here's the assignment, part of the assignment. Verse 19, he says, go therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. I am with you always. Underline that, mark it. I am with you always, because even in the difficult times in your life, Jesus says, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. Now, what does he say? He said, well, if we pray, God will make disciples. Is that what it says? All authority has been given me in heaven and earth. He said, go, therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptize them. Who is he talking to? He's talking to us. Well, he was talking to the disciples at the time, but there's a carried over testimony that comes to our generation. He's talking to us. In other words, you go make disciples. Isn't it amazing what happens a lot of times? They want to sit and pray and say, God, deliver me from this. God, take this away from me. God, when God is saying, no, I'm waiting for you to do something I can get involved with. And if you're doing my word and walking out my word, then now I can get involved with that. Now the authority that rests on Jesus, with Jesus on us, that same authority rests on us. But it only rests on us when we can understand and work through what Jesus has told us to do. Can't make it up yourself. Amen? So guess what? We have free rein to make disciples. What is a disciple? A disciple is a student, a learned one. In other words, we can entice people to learn from the Lord and go back to his word and learn of Jesus. Let me ask you something. How many of your disciples are in here this morning? How many disciples are watching me on live stream this morning? You're a disciple as long as you're learning. But when you stop learning, are you still considered a disciple? If you have no interest in the house of the Lord, can you consider yourself a disciple? If you have no interest in what God is doing in this hour, can you classify yourself into discipleship? I know you judge yourself, well, at least to be judged, but I mean, this is what we're talking about. Amen? He said, make disciples. Baptism is a sign that we're disciples of Christ. Amen. Water baptism. Amen? Praise the Lord. Baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Teach them to observe all things that I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always. What is he with us in? In the making of the disciples, in the carrying out of the assignment that he has given us, he's with us always. He's not with us always as far as, well, Jesus never leaves us. I mean, we carry the Spirit, so understand what I'm saying. But he's not obligated to interfere if you want him just to bless what you're doing. Wow. God is not our servant, we're his. Amen. Are you here? So this is what we need to understand. He's not obligated to do something because, well, Lord, you said in your word. Yes, he said in the word. Are you doing what he's called you to do in the word? Now he will be there to back it, and you can count on it. Amen? But if we have an idea of what we want to, how we want to be blessed, and we just want God to give us our blessing, but have no inclination at all to lay our life down to serve him, guess what? He's not obligated. And all authority is being given to Jesus. So there is no other authority than what Jesus contains within him. Satan doesn't have any authority. Certainly doesn't have any authority over your life or my life. He doesn't have any authority at all. Only what you'll give him. Amen. If you're willing to submit to anybody will have authority if you're willing to submit. But you're just stupid if you do. I mean, why would we? I mean, I submit myself to Christ. I submit my life to Christ and him. I got to get going. But I mean, how many got that so far? This is just Matthew. There's three synoptic gospels plus John. I mean, I'll talk about. Anyway, that's the one that I think is the most complete in one shot. But he said this in Acts chapter 1 and verse 8. He says to me, he says, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses to me in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and the ends of the earth. Two things he mentioned. All authority has been given unto me. But he says, you shall be endued with power. So two things I want to highlight here, power and authority. What's the difference? They're two separate words in the Greek. Matter of fact, if you look at Matthew 28, where it says all authority, the King James Version uses the word power in there instead of authority. But it's still the Greek word. It didn't change the Greek word. The Greek word is exousia. Is I saying that right, Maria? Exousia. Exousia? Thank you. I said it right. Sounded the same to me. All right. Maria's my Greek expert here. Praise the Lord. But the word power in Acts chapter 1 and verse 8, the word power is dunamis. I like that because it sounds like dynamite. Dynamite. I mean, praise the Lord, like explosive, you know. Dunamis is power. So there are two different Greek words, two different terms. So Jesus says you have authority and power. He says, in other words, remember he talked to the disciples and he said to the disciples, he says, it is expedient. In other words, it's to your advantage. That I go away. Now, I'm sure there wasn't one of the 11 disciples that were standing there listening to this agreed with that word. How many's ever had a word that Jesus spoke to you that you didn't agree with? Uh-huh. Thank you for your honesty. Praise the Lord. And the rest of you are just religious. Praise the Lord. Amen. But, just from my own sake, when God told me to come to Key West almost 34 years ago, I had an argument. I said, really? Okay, but what I'll do, I'll start out in obedience. Can I start in Key Largo? And I worked my way down with another pastor, and we were praying, walking our way down. And we never heard a thing from the Lord until we hit Key West. Not a thing. And we just saw, at Key West, it was like booming. Like, you'd have to be a jackass to miss it. I mean, you had to want to miss it on purpose. It was like that. God did everything for me but write it in the sky. This is where I want you. This is okay. Follow your last order first. He's never said anything. From here, I've gone around the world. I've preached the gospel on 5 different continents. Right from here, right from Key West Airport, because I ain't driving to Miami. I'll fly there. I ain't driving there. But anyway, praise the Lord. Amen. So he says in Mark chapter 16, there's another, some more of the, this is, they're writing this down as Jesus is saying, it's part of the commission, what we call the Great Commission. He said, go into all the world, preach the gospel. Now it's not just making disciples, it's preaching the gospel. Not just preaching, not just getting up and talking, but preaching the gospel. Bring the good news. Bring the things that Jesus was teaching, the things that he's teaching. He didn't say your theology is going to necessarily agree with it. I don't care about your theology. He said, preach the gospel. Don't preach your theology. No, we're not preaching your idea. We're preaching what Jesus has said, the gospel, and what he has given us and what he has shown us and how he's walked it out. Wow. Can I hear an amen? Amen. That's what we're doing. Preach the gospel to every creature. Creature? Well, I don't know about you. Got lizards in my backyard. I ain't preaching no gospel to the lizards. Now, the word creature, what he's referring to is every nationality, every language, everything, every person on the planet has entitled to this thing, preach the good news, preach the gospel. So that's the commission, that's the order. This is not a suggestion, by the way. This is not if you find time. This is what it's called to do in some way, shape, or form. Now, you may not be the one that is called to go preach these things, but certainly you are helping by supporting those that have the call to do those things. Praying, prayer support is a big thing. Well, I'll tell you, there's some places I've been to in Guatemala, it take you a week to get your hair combed back down. There's some things I've seen in West Africa, man, you don't never want to see them again. They're dark places in these kind. I'm not saying the whole country, but there's dark places that God will bring you to because you are the light that he wants to shine into those dark places. Amen. A lot of times, but maybe not. Maybe you're not, that was my call. That doesn't mean it's particularly your call. But guess what? I had lots of support. And I had a church that prayed. I appreciate a church that prayed when I was doing these things. But this was the commission. Everybody knows this. He who believes and is baptized shall be saved, he goes on to say in verse 16. But he who does not believe will be condemned. And these signs, listen, these signs shall follow those who believe. You're not following the signs. The signs are following you. All right? These signs shall follow them. In my name they shall cast out demons. Well, I thought that was just, I thought that was just superstition. No, it's real. He said, in my name you'll cast out demons. You will cast them out. He didn't suggest that you cast them out. He said, no. In my name, they will cast out, the ones that are called will cast out demons, as a matter of fact. They will speak with new tongues. That comes from the empowerment of what he gives in the book of Acts. Amen. But that wasn't the last thing. What I just gave you was not the last thing that Jesus said to his disciples. Here's the last thing. Are you ready for it? This is the last thing. Luke chapter 24 and verse 48-49. You are witnesses of these things. In other words, you saw all these things. You're witnesses of these things. Witnesses have a testimony. I'll get into that in a minute. He says, you are my witnesses of these things. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. He said, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until the end, until you are endued with power from on high. He said, in other words, don't leave Jerusalem until you've got the power. Isn't that amazing? He said, in other words, this is what you're going to need first. That was the last instruction that Jesus gave before he ascended into heaven. Amen? Now get this. Acts 1, verse 15, they're in the upper room. How many remember the upper room? How many were in the upper room? Does anybody know how many people were in the upper room? 120. I heard 120. 120 going once, 120 going twice. Sold, 120. Thank you, Cindy. Praise the Lord. 120. But here's something maybe you didn't know. Paul writes this in 1 Corinthians 15:6. He said, Jesus appeared to 500 brethren. In other words, at his resurrection, before his ascension, he appeared to 500. I got a question. Where's the other 380? What are they doing? Because it was 120 that believed Jesus. I don't know what the percentage-wise of that is. Believed Jesus and took him at his word and met in the upper room. I wonder what the 380 were doing. But he showed himself to. Now, how many remember what happened was Pentecost. The word Pentecost means 50. Pentecost comes 50 days after Passover. Jesus was resurrected on Passover, and he showed himself 40 days to 500 of the brethren. That's what happened. That meant at the ascension, at the end of 40 days, he ascended into heaven. After he said all these things, ascended into heaven, they had 10 days in that prayer meeting. What did they do for 10 days in a prayer meeting? And I don't know if the 500 started out, there was 120 left over. I don't know how this worked out. But Jesus told the same commission to over 500, or to the 500 brethren. 120 took it for serious and went and stayed in the upper room. Amen? Guess what? That 120 experienced what Jesus was sharing. There was 380 that missed out on the Pentecostal experience, so to speak, if I want to say it that way, because they weren't there. Jesus specifically says, he says, you tarry in Jerusalem, don't you leave. You stay here until this happens. I think it was a test in obedience more than anything else, it seemed like it. And a great earthquake hit. When that earthquake hit, of course, the Holy Spirit fell onto those in the upper room. And what happened was that speaking in tongues didn't attract the people. It was the earthquake. But many people from Jerusalem were all attracted to this one place. And what's going on? We heard an earthquake. You know, what's happening? And they heard them in their own language, speaking in tongues, and heard them in their own language. And then they said, these guys are drunk. So this must have been some kind of a chaotic event, because they call him, because Peter steps out and says, no, we're not drunk, it's only a third hour. I would have picked better words than that for me, but that's what Peter said anyway. And he said what happened was he began to preach about Jesus, and 3,000 souls gave their heart to the Lord in that one time. In that one day. So that was quite an experience. That's how the Holy Spirit came into the earth. Amen? Jesus said, all authority has been given unto us. There was an encounter with the Holy Spirit, and then there was an empowerment. Amen. Did you catch that?
Yes.
Just looking at the Pentecost, there was an empowerment that came after an encounter. But there had to be an encounter. To have the encounter, they had to be where God had placed them.
Amen.
It wasn't their choosing. They did not choose Jerusalem. They were from Galilee. And I'll tell you right now, it's about 70 miles or so from where they lived in Galilee to Jerusalem. They're away from home. But Jesus had told them, do not leave, do not depart. And we know there was 10 days that they didn't leave. They had to stay there in Jerusalem, whatever, how they were to stay. So they had a prayer meeting for 10 days where they had a prayer meeting where they sit there and talked about who was the greatest. Remember that little discussion on the road, and maybe they got all that stuff ironed out or sorted out. But the fact is, they had to be where Christ told them to be. They had to be in a geographical location to experience what Christ told them to experience. And that 120 experienced something that the remaining 380 never got a handle on. Why? Because they were where Jesus told them to be. Mm-hmm. Are you here this morning?
Yes.
Praise the Lord. Not only did they do that, I look at these scriptures. I've looked at these scriptures for years, and it just amazes me on the self-discipline and the obedience of these disciples. For one thing, they had to sit there and listen. This was Jesus. This was the guy that took the loaves and fishes, held them up to heaven, blessed, and asked for God's blessing on it, hand it back to the disciples, and God multiplied it enough to feed almost 10,000 people. The 5,000 men is what they said, but they didn't mention women or children. Took a little boy's lunch and magnified. They remembered that. Jesus showed him how to do that. He said, here, he held it up to the Father and he thanked him. What did he thank the Father for? He thanked the Father for not having enough. When he took it and passed it to the disciples, it was still the same. It still was short. But as they took it from Jesus and began to break the fish and the loaves, it began to multiply and multiply. Not only did they feed over almost 10,000 people or more, they had 12 baskets left over for themselves. What was the 12 baskets for? 3-day journey where God would take them to another place and he'll do it again. And this is the guy who says, it's better for me to go than to stay? That had to be mind-boggling. How is it better for Jesus to leave us? Jesus, you're the one who's providing for us. You're showing us the way. How is it better? Many times God will put you in a position where you think you're going downhill and he's really trying to get you uphill. Because what happens, better isn't our idea of what better or comfortable is. Better becomes what God says it is and what he fulfills through us. Can I use another example? Okay, I got a couple examples. Let me go to Paul. We know Paul, when he met Jesus on the road to Damascus, it changed his life. It changed his life, but it also changed his position. I don't mean his geographical location. I mean his position. He was in the Sanhedrin. He had the religious leaders. He was at the top of his game. He was a son of a Pharisee. He was a Pharisee. He had all these other things going for him. He had the education. He had the smarts. All of a sudden, he meets Jesus. He says, why are you persecuting me? Because he just had Stephen stoned to death, the first deacon in the church. And he changed like that. And he went blind. And Jesus sent another one of his disciples to lay hands on him. The scales fell off his eyes, so he got his sight back. From that point on, Paul did not go back, but went forward. But something else happened to Paul. Paul was a Jew. He was an exquisite Jew. I mean, a Jew of all Jews. But something happened to where he got a heart for the Gentile. Like nobody's business. I mean, not like Peter, not like any of the disciples. He had a heart for the Gentile. Now, you're talking about a man that never walked with Jesus. He didn't hear all. He didn't have the along the road conversations with him. He didn't have any of that. All he had was a vision of Jesus coming to him. He said, why are you persecuting me? And all of a sudden, it changed his entire life to where now this Jew of exquisiteness, higher echelon Jew, is now pining for the Gentile. So he keeps praying, God, send me to Rome. Let me go to Rome. He's at a gathering one day. And he runs across a man by the name of Agabus. Agabus was a prophet. Acts chapter 21, verse 10. It said, and we stayed many days. A certain prophet by the name of Agabus came down from Judea. And when he came to us, he took Paul's belt, bound his hands and feet, and said, thus saith the Holy Spirit. Okay? So shall the Jews in Jerusalem. This is his bunch. So will the Jews in Jerusalem bind the man who owns this belt and delivers him into the hands of the Gentile. Guess what? We're going to Rome. So the very guys that he used to pander with, the very guys that he used to be part of, now turncoat on him and are going to turn him over to the Gentiles. Why? Because they figure the Gentiles aren't going to be fair to a Jew. He got no chance. They want to do him in. But Paul's been praying. He says, send me to Rome. Send me to Rome. I'm sure his idea of going to Rome was different than God's idea of him getting to Rome. Because Paul didn't go as a preacher. He went as a prisoner. I said it that way because it just has two P's in it. Sounds cool. But that's the truth. Remember, he's sitting on a ship. He's bound. He's telling the guys, don't sail today, not a good day to sail. Gonna hit a hurricane, don't sail. Oh, who are you? Shut up, you're just a prisoner. Get out in the middle of the Mediterranean, guess what they hit? Now the ship go down. He says, stay with the ship and no life will be lost. Stay with the ship and all. But now they're listening a little better. There was a Roman guard assigned to Paul 24/7. I don't know if they were linked together, however. Paul is getting exactly what his heart desired from the Lord. Can you imagine the guy hooked up to Paul? You're not going to hear nothing out of him but Jesus. I mean, can you imagine? By the time before he even got to Rome or to any place else, before he even went to a storm, he had everybody on that ship. He preached to. Then he goes to Rome. And what do? They bring him before Caesar himself, but as a prisoner. As a prisoner. I don't know if you know this or not, but I'm going to share some things with you. 13 books in this Bible were written by Paul. I mean, the penmanship. Of course, we all know it's the Holy Spirit written. But 13 books here were written by Paul. Are you ready for this? Paul went to prison. And he ends up dying in prison at the ripe old age of 61, 62, something like that. He wasn't very an old man, but he died in prison. At the time he died, seven of those 13 books that he wrote were while he was in prison. Can I suggest to you this morning that no matter what the circumstances, the will of God was carried out. No matter what positioning, he wasn't waiting until he got free before he starts doing the commission that Christ had given. Nope. Okay. Is this what we're doing? Okay, we're going. I mean, talk about a bad day. You're going in chains. You're bound to a Roman soldier. The ship runs into a hurricane. They stay with the boat. No life is lost. They're trying to wrap the ship because the ship's coming apart like a cheap watch. All of a sudden, they come up to the island of Malta. They get off the island. They finally swim the shore. Paul is helping out. He's carrying wood. And he gets bit by a snake, a viper, a deadly viper. He shakes it off into the fire and continues on doing what he's doing. And they're all amazed because all the Maltese people are looking at him. So he's going to die any minute. Right. But he doesn't die. What's the matter with him? He didn't die. What? He was bit. We saw him bit with a snake, but he didn't die. I don't know. In most Christian circles, that would be counted as a bad day. But Paul was seeing something different. No. He wasn't seeing the bad day. He was seeing God's will being carried out. Oh, this is just an annoyance. I'm seeing God's will called out. Bit by a viper? I shook it off. Isn't it? Look, it's not even swollen. That's not a bad day. Look at, because I got bit and I'm not dying. All of these people, I got all their attention. God set on a stage. Well, he's in prison. He gets special treatment eventually. He gets special treatment to where he gets a runner, a carib, and he's actually apostling the churches from a Roman prison where he wrote seven more books of the Bible. Amen? Some of those books are, Romans is one that he wrote before he was a prisoner. 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, Galatians. 1 Thessalonians, 2 Thessalonians were the six books he wrote before he was a prisoner. Here's the books that he wrote when he was in prison. Ephesus, Philippians, Colossians, 1 and 2 Timothy, Titus, and Philemon. He wrote those while he was incarcerated. He wrote those while he was chained to Romans. That must have been awkward. In other words, what are we going with this, Pastor? In other words, the assignment of Christ cannot stop because of circumstances. The worshiping of God cannot be put on hold because we have other things to do. The purpose of God, when we put God first place and the things that he has for us first place, then God can be about our business. Whose desire was it to go to Rome? Paul's. God never indicated that was his vision. But Paul said, no, if I could just go to Rome and get to the Gentiles. He was already Antioch. Antioch was the biggest Gentile gathering you can imagine. There was Jews there too. But there was in Antioch, man, he had an audience. How many's ever heard the word Christian? How many's ever been accused of that? I hope everybody in this sanctuary has been accused. You know where that term came from? Antioch. It's a Gentile term. That means nothing to a Jew. To a person, to us, Christian means a follower of Christ. That term came from Antioch and the church of Antioch. That Paul was over. Help anybody this morning. Praise the Lord. Are we learning anything? Okay, at least praise the Lord. Gideon. Can I talk about Gideon? I got 6 minutes. I can do this. Praise the Lord. Gideon. I shared Gideon. This is one of my favorite Old Testament stories, because you know why? Gideon, just like we are. Doubtful, you know, stubborn in the face of God. Come on, you might as well laugh at yourself or somebody else will. Praise the Lord, amen. Anyway, in Judges, this is interesting. You know the story, I went over this before, Gideon's threshing wheat in a wine press. If you got to thresh wheat in a wine press, you're hiding. You're not threshing wheat. Wheat is, you're not going to get much wheat out of threshing in a small confined area. Amen. You need big broad areas so the wind can take the chaff and so on and so forth. That's how they do it. But Gideon's trying to get enough food because the enemy, every time they grow crops, the enemy would come in and take out the crops, take it for themselves, and then burn the rest. And scorched earth policy was the policy of the enemy. And the people cried out to God for a deliverer. And the angel come up, he's sitting under a tree, and here's Gideon. And he says, thou mighty man of valor, God will never agree with your depression. He will never agree with your bad positioning. He'll never agree with your weaknesses, because if he does, you'll never get rid of them. So what he said to Gideon, he says, Gideon, he says, a mighty man of valor. He said, I'm not a mighty man of valor. He said, I come from Manasseh. I'm the least in my family. My family's the least in the tribe. The tribe is the least in Israel. And we have the least, the least, the least, the least, the least. In other words, I'm just a bug here to be stepped on by the enemy. The angel listens to all this. When Gideon gets done ranting and raving, sometimes like we do, he turns to the angel and says, go in this strength of yours, you mighty man of valor. What he just demonstrated and what he just gave was not strength, it was weakness. What happened next, you really have to take apart the Hebrew to really understand it. But what happens next is something that is really, really something else. It's in Judges chapter 6 and verse 34. I haven't shared this before, so this is going to be new to some of you. It says, the Spirit of the Lord came upon Gideon. That's what the Bible says. That's the New King James translation, whatever translation says. That particular scripture, and this is after he says, go in this strength of yours. In other words, he let Gideon vent. God had all kinds of mercy for this guy. I don't know why, but he had all kinds of mercy. And he said he let him go. So when he got done, he said the first thing, he said, the mighty man of valor. The second thing he said, the last thing he said to Gideon was, go with this strength of yours, you mighty man of valor. In other words, Gideon's complaining didn't change the mind of God. Neither will yours. Ours. Our complaining doesn't change the purpose God has for us. Our complaining and our theological arguments do not bear any weight with God. He still will say the same thing at the end, thou mighty man of valor, go in this strength of yours. What strength? He was talking weakness. But God is not going to say what he sees. He's going to say what he says. He's going to speak this over him, and it's going to come upon him. When I got to this verse here, I took it apart in the Hebrew, and this is what I found out. But the Spirit of the Lord came upon, underline that, came upon Gideon. You know what it means? It means this in Hebrew. I don't know how you get your mind around this thing, but this is what it means. It's kind of bizarre, but what it means is God put Gideon on like a coat. That's what it says in Hebrew. It says the word in the Hebrew is labash. And labash means to wrap around, that is to put on a garment or clothe oneself. Gideon didn't have what God needed, so God came into Gideon, and Gideon became the clothing of God. What does he do next? We know what Gideon does next. He goes, he tears down the altars of Baal, and he blows a trumpet, and 32,000 troops line up behind him and said, we're ready to fight with you. We'll come against the enemy. Why? He's clothed. God has used him, used Gideon like a garment. It's God standing there in Gideon's place. Wow. Yes. And then God begins to observe, and he tells Gideon, send these home. Now, it's too many to give to the hands of man. And he comes down to 300. He reduces it down. How many know this for to be a fact? We can look at Gideon. The reduction of numbers was not punishment, but empowerment. When God said there's too many to give into the hands of the Midianites, means that there was too many for them to get killed. They're going to get killed because their hearts aren't into the warfare. So God had to reduce the numbers. It wasn't punishment for Gideon. It was empowerment, because now the 300 have to do, excuse me, what 32,000 were supposed to do. So what happens? How do you get 300 men and women to do what 32,000 are supposed to do? Is you have to empower them. Do you see what I'm saying about empowerment? Empowerment is for the task at hand. Mm-hmm. To sit in front of a TV set and keep flipping the channels, you don't need the empowerment of God. You really don't. If every once in a while you wake up with a headache, you don't need the power of God to cure that headache, because Jesus already took that from you. You just claim it. There's nothing for you to do. But to step out in the things that look impossible, like take on a city like Key West, now we need God's empowerment. Now I'm paying attention. Amen? Because there doesn't seem to be enough here to get the job done. I mean, if we had half the city, we probably wouldn't seem enough to get the job done. But the fact is, it doesn't seem to be enough. But God is a Lord over things that seem to be shortages, and Gideon will agree with that. Amen? Amen? So two men I mentioned this morning, Paul, to recap, and Gideon. Paul had it on his heart to go ahead and go to Rome. But God sent him by a different way than what he expected. What would happen to today if something happened and God got us through, but it was different than what we expected? Are we going to love him or curse him? Amen? Gideon had to interrupt his routine. I'm sure he had a routine on thrashing wheat, and he had a good idea on how to thrash wheat. But he couldn't do that and still do the way God wants to do. So God put him on like a coat and says, together, let's go get the enemy. Gideon, out of that 300, didn't lose one man. Not even close. As a matter of fact, what God did, he did something supernatural. He put a fear in the camp of the enemy. Are you here? Amen. There's two things that we understand. Do you think Gideon knew that God was with him? How many of you think Gideon knows? It's not a trick question. I just think what your opinion is. My opinion? Yeah. If God puts you on like a coat, you can't help but know God. You go to sleep with God, you wake up with God, you eat with God, you talk with, and everything about it is Jehovah, is presence is there. Do you know we have the same privilege when we come together, where two or three are gathered, Jesus and my spirit is in the midst of those gathered? He's not putting us on like a coat, like that was different. That was a little bit bizarre, but that's what's different for Gideon. But Jesus is there. If we came to church for no other reason, I mean, if there was no message going forth, there was no music, wouldn't it be worth it to go to church where Jesus would be at? What if we gathered in the name of Christ? Would it still be worth it? Then I got to assume, by that affirmation, I got to assume that when we're not gathering here, or when we don't feel like gathering here, it's not the Spirit of God. Because you just acknowledge it's worth our while to come together regardless of what happens. It's not what we do, it's not our positioning, but what He's called us to do. Helping anybody?
Yes.
I woke up, I went to sleep last night with this on my mind. I woke up this morning and it was ringing in my ear again. I'm going to close with this. People don't realize it, but Paul writes this in Romans. Paul's one of my heroes in the New Testament, if you didn't figure that one out yet, as far as all the disciples. Jesus is my real hero, but I mean, Paul, I love his tenacity. Romans chapter 14 and verse 17 says, for the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. How many has ever read that scripture or memorized that scripture? I'll read it again. For the kingdom of God is not eating or drinking. That's not what the kingdom of God is. And we have fellowship last Sunday of the month, and we have a good time. But that's not the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Do you know what that means? That means that that's a felt reality. Amen. It's tangible. You can feel it. If you have peace, can you feel peace? Yes. If you have joy, how many have joy? Can you feel joy? Yes. The only thing is that righteousness isn't felt, but two out of the three is a felt reality. Amen? Here's what happens, and I came out of religion, so I'm gonna share this, but religion idolizes concept. It idolizes concept but avoids personal experience. The abiding presence of the Holy Spirit must be a felt reality. Otherwise, Jesus just becomes a concept. And if that's all we have to go on, I'm not taking on the enemy on a concept. I want the presence and the felt reality of Christ. But if the kingdom of God is not meat or drink, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost, there's three things, righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Ghost. And two of those are felt realities. There should be no doubt in our minds that we're in the kingdom of God and that God's presence is in a place. If God's presence is a felt reality, not just a concept, weigh those two things out, then we should know when we're in the presence of God and when we're not. Correct? Because we're not talking about concept, but we're talking about personal experience, the thing religion avoids. I was in religion, and all of a sudden a guy witnessed to me about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. But the church I was in didn't believe in that. So I went back and told them my experience. But you see, their concept didn't agree with my experience. So basically, my experience must have been flawed, even though I had biblical proof. All right, I'm probably close with that because I got a whole bunch of other stuff, and I got three more pages that I don't have time to go over to this morning. But how many got something out of the Word this morning? I know I give you a bunch of stuff to think about, and this is all recorded, so you can go back over if you missed something I said because you're a daydreamer or went to Hawaii and came back or not. But the fact is I shared this message this morning because I feel we're in a season we need to know this. And though things may be maybe a discomfort or whatever, you got to know because you got to be know. We're in a changing world right now. Remember, the Bible talks about the end times. There'll be wars and rumors of wars. Well, we no longer have rumors of wars. We have wars. And it's not so much the wars around the globe. It's where they're located that's got my attention. And I'm not crying, well, God's coming back tomorrow and you all need to give it. No, I'm not talking about that at all. I'm saying, what is the church's responsibility in the last days? If you believe we live in the last days, how close we are, it doesn't matter. No one knows the day or the hour but the Father anyway. But the fact is how is the church supposed to position itself? I had to talk to my leadership this morning before the service. We should be positioning ourselves not on a defensive. This church should be on the offensive, not towards people, not against people, or politics. Good Lord, don't get me there. Amen? But on the offensive towards the powers of darkness. And do what we need to do, come against the powers of darkness. This is the hour. Yes. And what Satan tries to do, he tries to diminish our purpose in God in an effort to deflect us from it. Mm-hmm. You understand? Because he has no authority. I just read to you this morning, God's got all the authority. He has no authority, so all he has is manipulative capabilities. Amen? Amen. He'll make you think things that you never thought you could think. And then when you start thinking on those things for a long time, that thinking becomes meditation, and meditation becomes seated in the soul, and all of a sudden it becomes a belief system. Yep. And it all started with, has God really said? He used that stupid line all the way back to the Garden with Eve. And he used the same line of the temptation of Christ in the wilderness. If you be the Son of God, turn these rocks into loaves of bread. Why? If I am the Son of God, I'll just translate myself to the supermarket. Watch me translate. Bill did it. I can do it. Watch me translate right into Publix ice cream aisle. Anybody ever go on a fast and you can't get food out of your mind? Oh, praise God, I'm not going to. Anyway. Like right now. And you had breakfast. Oh, you didn't? Not yet? Oh, okay, praise the Lord. So we'll call it brunch then. Praise the Lord. Let's go ahead and pray. Father, we just thank you for your word this morning in the name of Jesus. We thank you for what you've given us. And I hope we got our general thinking headed into a direction, Father God, that will add to this church, add to our ministry, but more than that, Father God, add to your kingdom. You've commissioned us not to build a work or not to build a ministry. We do that anyway. We do that it's just a natural thing. You commissioned us to build the kingdom of God and to bring people into the kingdom of God by the gospel. I pray, Father God, that your anointing fall on everybody in this room that heard this message this morning. And Lord, that you bless them in the name of Jesus. And whatever that means. But Lord, help us to understand that not every difficulty is the devil. And not every difficult situation can be placed in not all things, but there are some that are there for our spiritual growth and edification. And we thank you, Father God, at the end of the day that we will find ourselves in your glory and find ourselves looking towards you, the author and finisher of our faith. Yes. Help us with that felt reality, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. And all the church said,
amen.
God bless you. Hallelujah. Thank you for that little extra few minutes.